The Witcher's world is teeming with monsters, both the human and big pointy teeth kind. In fact, it's so full of the latter that we couldn't cover all of them in just one pass. But you guys totally supported our last piece, thank you so much. So, like we promised, we're back to dig up the real-world origins of the monsters in the second half of The Witcher's first season. It's monster mythology! Well, there's a tiny little problem with the first monster we see in episode 6. No one ever says its name.
Let's get on before the beast gets hungry again.
And we only get a short glimpse of this toothy, raptor-like, disembodied head. So first we'll have to solve a monster mystery by going back to the Witcher books. This episode is based on Sword of Destiny's Bounds of Reason, and Geralt starts that by hunting a basilisk. And just to be safe, we checked with showrunner Lauren Schmidt-Hissrich, who said, yes, it is a basilisk, one of many subspecies that might or might not be in development. Ooh, scoop. Although proportions vary by the tale, the basilisk is typically portrayed as some mixture of reptile and chicken, born of a rooster's egg, yes, rooster, that was incubated by a toad, which admittedly sounds really silly, but counterpoint, isn't a T-Rex kind of a mixture of a chicken and a reptile? And like the T-Rex, the basilisk is considered a king, the little king of the serpents in Greek. But you can argue that its formidable arsenal of monstrous weapons makes it way more dangerous than these beasts and or puny dinosaurs. Like a dragon, it could breathe fire, and its hiss could kill, so could its odor. In fact, it was so very toxic that its venom was known to travel up a man's spear to kill him and the horse he rode on. And scholars thought its native habitat of Libya was actually a verdant paradise until basilisk toxins turned it into the Sahara. And we haven't even gotten to its famous death stare yet, which even rivals Geralt's. The basilisk stare was thought to be instantly fatal. Humans in antiquity went to great lengths to protect themselves from it. For instance, in Warsaw in 1587, the citizenry sent a convicted felon into a suspected basilisk lair wearing a suit of mirrored armor, like he was on the basilisk bomb squad or something. By the way, Warsaw now has this cool basilisk statue, which we thought you might like to see. Aside from Geralt, who kills them pretty easily without the aid of mirrors, the basilisk did have one powerful enemy that the dinosaurs didn't have. You may have seen it earlier. It's the weasel. Yes, despite all those instant kill weapons, a smelly weasel could somehow take out a basilisk. Some even think that this bloody mythical rivalry originated in the real-life enmity between cobra and mongoose. But whatever its origins and weaknesses, these peasants possess a certain amount of wisdom about the basilisk.
It's been an hour. Let's get on before the beast gets hungry again.
The Hirika is a rare creature within the world of The Witcher, and unfortunately, it's even more rare after the incident in episode 6. But it's also the first monster we've encountered that was created out of thin air by Witcher author Andrzej Sapkowski. As far as I can tell, it's only mentioned in The Sword of Destiny, and there just 2 times. But we do get important information that the Hirika is so endangered that Geralt won't accept a contract on one. The show expands on that. The exceedingly rare Hirika lives in a forest. It changes from something cute to something frightening, but it's harmless if given food.
It's probably starving. Feed your weapons.
Oh yeah, and absolutely do not eat it. That said, I'm not the only one that sees some passing resemblance between the show's Hirikas and the more modern form of gremlins. They're both rare creatures with giant eyes and ears that undergo some transformation that humans find terrifying, and they also have a few important dietary rules. Although you'll probably never see Gizmo like this. R.I.P. Hirika. And now we get to the granddaddy of all monsters, the dragon. If you've only seen certain fantasy shows, Dracarys, An intelligent, likable dragon like Borch 3 Jackdaws may not be so familiar to you, but the thing about the dragon is that it has arisen separately in so many cultures that it's not just one thing. In the West, the dragon is typically depicted as an evil beast, but even that doesn't mean it's been static over the course of its history. Even the Greek name has multiple meanings, serpent on its face, but trace that back and you get to see clearly. And in the time of the ancient Greeks, dragons were the worst, literal enemies of the gods. Typhon fought and fell to Zeus, the worm Nidhogg gnawed on the roots of the world tree in Scandinavia, and of course, the Book of Revelations prophesied that the Christian devil would come back as a multi-headed red dragon. That didn't help the dragon's image. But when spinners of tales started writing about dragons as creatures on Earth, they weren't necessarily what we associate with our familiar Western dragons.
Roll a saving throw against dragon's breath!
Pliny the Elder, a Roman natural historian who would influence generations, wrote about dragons as almost boa constrictors, killing with their powerful tails. So strangely, there's almost a millennium of accounts of dragons hunting elephants, their supposed favorite prey, that are straight out of nature documentaries.
Ah! The now wary elephant and her calf move swiftly to the depths of the river, giving the hungry dragon no other option than to seek new feeding grounds.
And dragons of this era were terrified of the supposedly godly panther. You don't see that much anymore. Getting away from that early depiction seemed difficult. Beowulf's famous dragon flies and breathes fire and hoards treasure like future dragons would, but it's also said to coil and to possess a venomous bite like a snake. In fact, it wasn't until the 1200s that the first known modern dragon appears in a manuscript, a winged, four-legged, fire-breathing red dragon that would become part of many a knight's stories.
For kingdom and glory!
But even then, the bestiaries varied by author, spawning amazing, now forgotten dragon facts like this one. It was thought that dragon urine, which obviously would rain down from the sky, would putrefy human tissue upon contact. Anyway, that's just the West. Because the East has had its own distinct dragon culture maybe since the year 3000 BCE, and they're not evil at all. In fact, they're considered powerful and lucky, revered as celestial beings that could control the rain among other aspects of reality. They were even adopted as symbols of the Chinese emperor. And while they are still largely flying serpents, the Eastern dragon is typically believed to include parts of 9 different beasts. Plus, they were known to change size and shapeshift into human form, so perhaps the Witcher's gold dragon was influenced by them as much as the West. Of course, we don't know why dragons arose in this many cultures. Scholars cite misunderstood evidence of dinosaurs or a deep fear of crocodiles. But I do know I always love to see them, which is why Lauren Schmidt Hisrick's idea that there are gold dragon witchers that protect other dragons from humans should immediately be greenlit by my superiors at Netflix. Thank you for your consideration. Some thought that the nasty monster whose bite poisoned Geralt in the final episode was a Necker, originally a dangerous type of water spirit in Northern European folklore. But Lauren confirmed for us that this was indeed a pack of ghouls we saw burrowing through the corpse-strewn battlefield. And maybe the most surprising thing I learned in the course of researching all these monsters is that the original ghoul isn't undead. What are you doing to me, D&D's Monsters Manual? Belief in the ghoul began pre-Islam in a sort of mythological exchange between the societies of Mesopotamia and Arabian nomads. But the ghoul was probably helped along when the Hadith, a book of the prophet's sayings, not always but sometimes, acknowledged the creature's existence. Rather than being undead, though, they were a dangerous class of the already volatile spirits called jinn, which we saw in episode 5, remember? And as if that wasn't bad enough, they had been corrupted by Iblis, the devil of Islam, so as to exact revenge on humanity. It wasn't such a hard task, considering their ability to shapeshift from their disease-bearing, clawed, animalistic forms to that of seductive women, although their hoof-like footprints could give them away. Nor were they easy to kill. You had to do it in one perfect stroke, or they could come back. ghouls prowled for travelers in forgotten places, like wastelands or derelict buildings or graveyards. But in the original incarnation, they didn't actually eat the dead. They love living human flesh, true, and strangely, there are accounts of ghouls going crazy for dates. But it's worth mentioning that the reason we all believe that ghouls eat the dead is because one of the early translators of 1001 Arabian Nights embellished, and it caught on. Of course, this is all probably rather academic if you're dying a painful death from a ghoul bite. Still, even a surly witcher would agree that it's important to know your monster. And there it is! All the monsters that made it into The Witcher's epic first season. The only question is, what creatures do you want to see in the second season? Let us know in the comments. For me, I think I want a chort. Until then, happy hunting. For anyone wondering, there was one monster left on the cutting room floor, according to LSH. Geralt originally took a contract for a Polvic in episode 6, but Yennefer beat him to the punch, obviously leading to them, you know. Anyway, in Slavic mythology, the Polvic is a grassy-haired field spirit that can change size depending on the surrounding plants. But it can be hostile, especially to those who fall asleep in the fields. The only way to get in good with one was to offer it 2 eggs and a rooster that could no longer crow while no one was looking. LSH says the show version was, and I quote, so cute. Maybe next time.